Where do Republicans and Democrats go from here? The highly contentious Roe v. Wade decision sending both parties on very different paths. The question is, which one will voters follow? The decision has monopolized conversation since last Friday. Bars, supermarkets, summer picnics, office water coolers. I've been to all of them today. And I'll tell you, everyone has an opinion. And now lawmakers on both sides of the aisle are trying to turn that energy into votes. Democrats have obviously been freaking out. The problem is the Roe decision has not united them. In fact, it has pushed progressives even further from the center. And now people like Congresswoman Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez are openly opposing the president's tactics. Watch.
The Supreme Court has engaged in the overreaching of its authority in denying the human and civil rights of any pregnant person. Biden should entertain expansion of the Supreme Court. He should forcefully come out in ending the filibuster.
He should fire Sonia Sotomayor. What AOC fails to realize is that her aggressively leftist positions tend to alienate moderate voters, of which there are more. But cooler heads in the party say they see an opening, and it could be with suburban broads, I like it, who say they're upset with the Supreme Court decision. But it's a heavy lift because the party is hemorrhaging that exact demographic because of inflation and crime and education. Can they win the ladies back? We shall see. Here's the rub. Republicans are also trying to thread a needle over Roe. Polling shows the majority of Americans support access to abortion, so it's not politically expedient to run a campaign vowing to shut everything down. So what's the happy medium for the GOP? RNC Chairwoman Ronna McDaniel claims she doesn't think the issue really moves the needle.
We'll be looking at recent polling, but I'll say this, Brian, it was leaked in April, remember? So this is a little baked in, and we have seen no movement in the polling once this was leaked. So I think a lot of voters had seen this. They expected Roe v. Wade to be overturned, and it did not change the numbers at all.
Glossy and sassy. Grr, Ronna. Essentially, don't make too many waves on abortion and remind voters about price hikes and violence under the Biden administration instead. So in light of last week's ruling, which party is now better poised for victory? Let's get into it with tonight's man panel. We've got Washington Examiner, senior political columnist, and American Enterprise Institute resident fellow, Tim Carney. He's our kind of fellow. We've got the host of The Richard Fowler Show. It is a radio show. He is Richard Fowler, always at the ready. And we've got the host of the Part of the Problem podcast. You clamor for him, and he has been delivered. Dave Smith is also back. Gentlemen, welcome one and all. So, Tim, I will start with you. What's the smartest thing for Republicans to do here? Is it to just completely ignore the decision and move on to inflation? Is that possible?
No, this decision has finally returned abortion, the protection of innocent human lives, the protection of babies. It's returned that to the Democratic realm. So it's incumbent on Republican lawmakers, especially on the state level, to go ahead and pass laws to protect the unborn babies. And I just moved to Virginia, and I think the state Senate majority leader there, who's a Democrat, will be surprised. She says, oh, we're not voting on anything like a 16-week ban. She'll be surprised how many vulnerable Democrats show up and say, excuse me, you will become the minority leader if we don't pass something. So I think you will see purple states, Republicans, move ahead boldly because they know that the compromise position is let's ban abortion at least in the second trimester. And then in the red states, they'll be more aggressive in protecting the unborn.
So, Richard, is that a gift to Democrats, what Tim is talking about right now?
Listen, I take the politics out of this decision, and I think about the women in my life and why this decision is so important to them. And here's
because
what I know.
Because they were born?
There's so many, that part. But even beyond that, there's so many women that when you say we're going to just do an outright ban on abortion like you see taking place in South Dakota or Montana, there's other externalities to that. What happens to a family, a husband and a wife who have a fetus where the heart is it sort of developing inside the body? What happens to that particular pregnancy? What happens to a pregnancy where there's an incomplete miscarriage, and they're in a state like Oklahoma, and they can't get the particular procedures they need to end that miscarriage? There's so many different externalities that Roe protected against that it's really important to talk about that, and I think that's what Democrats are going to do in this moment. They're going to pick the states that have had the most extreme regressive laws and point out how they limit a woman's ability to make decisions that don't belong at the Supreme Court, that don't belong with any of the men on this panel, but actually belong between a woman and her OBGYN.
So do men have a say in the abortion debate, Dave?
Well, I guess the men on the Supreme Court had some say, and men who are elected representatives have some say. Just to Richard's point, I actually have a son who was born with a heart condition, thank God is doing okay. And it's interesting that when these like very rare, very extreme examples are brought up, and perhaps in some certain situations like that, there should be some type of exemption. But of course, as someone who's pro-life from the pro-life position, it's kind of it's funny to hear you talk about the externalities because, of course, the externality of every single abortion is a dead baby. So the pro-life position is that it's morally indistinguishable to kill a baby outside of the womb versus inside of the womb. And if you don't deal with that argument, then it just seems kind of silly to say, well, in certain situations, there are these externalities. Look, as far as you're talking about the politics of the situation, there are always costs associated with a political victory. Donald Trump gets elected, but then there's a lot of energized left-wingers. And I don't think this is going to move the needle with suburban moms or suburban women. I do think it will energize left-wing activists. Midterm elections are a lot about energizing your base. There will be a benefit there for Democrats. I just don't think it's going to be nearly enough to outweigh the negatives for Democrats, which is the state of everything.
So, Tim, when you saw the draft decision come down in May, did you think that this would settle the issue culturally?
No, but it allows the beginning of settling the issue culturally. If you read Antonin Scalia's dissent in Planned Parenthood v. Casey, when some people thought they were going to overturn Roe, and of course the court upheld it, he said, the justices in the majority of Roe and Casey believe they are settling it. They are not. And if you ever came down to a March for Life here, if you ever witnessed any of the politics, they did not. But you know what settles debates? When people get to argue, get to debate, get to vote, and even if they lose, maybe they get a compromise, maybe they just lose, people are much more willing to live with that. We haven't gotten to have that debate because the court took it out of the Democratic realm. Now with Dobbs, the court has returned it to the realm of democracy. That's what allows us to have political peace.
And we will have, we'll be passing the political peace pipe in a little bit. I have a uterus. I demand it. I'm going to shackle you with my fallopian tubes, man panel, and demand that you stay put. More with them in just a bit.